On the behalf of Mahavet, I will request Dr. Santosh Vakchaure sir to please introduce our session and speaker for today's session. Please.
Dear friends, I am pleased to start our first webinar. The topic for today's session is clinical approach for diagnosis and therapeutic management of metabolic and deficiency disorders in bovines. The speaker is Honorable Dr. Bikani sir. Bikani sir is currently university head of veterinary clinical medicine at Mapsu, Maharashtra. He is also a president of Veterinary Internal and Preventive Medicine Society, India. Dr. Bikani sir is well known for his vast experience in ruminant as well as in canines. So I welcome all participants as well as Honorable Professor Dr. Bikani sir for this session. Now I request our honorable speaker to start with his topic.
Yeah. I think little disturbance is there. Please mute all. Dr. Mangesh sir, please mute everyone so that Bikani sir will deliver very well. There will be no disturbance.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
So at the outset, I extend thanks to Maharashtra Veterinary Association, Veterinary Internal and Preventive Medicine Society, and Veterina Private Limited for organizing a webinar during this lockdown period due to COVID outbreak. Mahavet President Dr. Ramdas Gade, Mahavet Secretary Dr. Santosh Vakchaure, Executive President Dr. Shashikant, all the office bearers of the Veterinary Internal and Preventive Medicine Society, Vice President, Secretary, Joint Secretary, and the Chairman of VetZone and Veterina Healthcare, Dr. Mangesh. So I thank all of them for organizing this webinar and giving me opportunity to interact with the academic staff, veterinarians, as well as the veterinary students from all over the country. We are passing through a very critical period due to this COVID-19 outbreak. Even during this critical period, veterinarians, they are serving the dumb animals, they are serving the farmers. They are going to the doorstep of our animal owners and giving essential and emergency type of treatment. So I salute all the veterinarians as a corona warriors for devoting themselves to the national war. And I come to my topic, that is a clinical approach for diagnosis and therapeutic management of metabolic and deficiency disorders in dairy animals. So you all know that the metabolic diseases, they have become very common all over the world, including our India. These metabolic diseases are also termed as the production diseases, and they are occurring in crossbred animals, exotic animals, as well as high-yielding buffaloes from our country. Among the different metabolic or production diseases, milk fever, ketosis, and hypomagnesemia are considered very important metabolic or production diseases all over the world. But in Indian scenario, I consider that PPH and osteomalacia are very important and common metabolic disorders occurring in our Indian buffaloes as well as Indian cows, in addition to milk fever and ketosis. Therefore, today we'll discuss these four diseases, particularly their etiology in brief, and the diagnostic aspects, particularly in depth, and the therapeutic aspects. I have been working on metabolic diseases for last 30 years. As a teacher also, I'm engaged in teaching metabolic diseases to UG as well as PG students. I am here going to share my practical clinical experience with all of you. I will welcome the suggestions, additions from your side too, because I know that academic staff members, pretty senior veterinarians, they have also joined this particular webinar, and definitely they are having their own experiences in diagnosis as well as the therapeutic management of metabolic diseases. So milk fever is one of the commonest metabolic disorder occurring throughout the world. It is also known as the parturient paresis. And this particular milk fever is a sporadic disease, occurs in one or two animals in a herd, but sometimes the incidence may go high up to 5 to 7%, particularly on high on a farm where high yielding animals are being maintained. But the most important thing which is being neglected is a subclinical hypocalcemia. And it has been reported that the incidence of subclinical hypocalcemia in high-yielding animals is as 66%. And in my opinion, this is important from the economic point of view. Milk fever, you all know that it is an emergency type of condition, and if not treated in time, animal will die due to circulatory failure. But apart from this, milk fever increases risk of dystocia, retention of placenta, metritis, prolapse of uterus, as well as abomasal displacement by threefold at the time of calving. It also increases the risk of ketosis and mastitis by 8 to 9-fold. Milk fever cases, they also suffer from musculoskeletal injuries during the recovery phase. During the illness, during the recumbency, the digestive disturbances like bloat are likely to develop, which are followed by regurgitation and aspiration pneumonia. Milk fever is caused by hypocalcemia, which is due to either animal risk factors or dietary risk factors. We have been giving more importance to the animal risk factors for a long time, but recently the dietary factors have also gained importance. Milk fever or hypocalcemia is caused by hypocalcemia due to excess loss or drain of calcium through the colostrum, accompanied by slow mobilization of calcium from bone or skeleton. Normally, milk contains 1.2 gram of the calcium, but colostrum contains double the amount of calcium. And therefore, there is a sudden loss of large amount of calcium through the colostrum at the time of starving. On the other side, the parathormone deficiency and vitamin D3 deficiency may cause slow mobilization of calcium from bone and skeleton. Here I would like to share that the calcium pool in the blood is very less. It is around 4 to 5 grams. And in just 1 kg of colostrum, 2.3 gram of calcium is being lost. If animal produces 1.5 to 2 kg of the colostrum, means it is losing 4 to 5 grams of calcium. So even that much calcium is not present in the blood. So during this emergency, the calcium has to be drained from the bone. And this work is being done by parathyroid gland, which releases the parathormone. So it is done under the effect of parathormone as well as vitamin D3. Both are important in the mobilization of calcium protein. In addition to this, the decreased absorption at the time of calving may be due to anorexia or inappetence, resulting from digestive disturbance, ruminal dysfunction, indigestion, contributes to hypocalcemia. The calcium phosphorus ratio is also considered very important in the absorption of calcium as well as phosphorus from the GI tract. But ruminants, they can tolerate the calcium phosphorus ratio as wide as 7:1 against 2:1 in simple stomached animals. And therefore, too wide or too narrow ratio of calcium and phosphorus results into decreased absorption on absorption of calcium from the GI tract during the critical period. Apart from these animal risk factors, dietary risk factors include the calcium and phosphorus intake. Excess of calcium intake during the advanced pregnancy, particularly the dry period, results into hypocalcemia at the time of calving. This is somewhat surprising.
Video म्हणजे त्यांना बघायचं असेल तर पडतं येते
का? Calcium intake, if it is too high during advanced pregnancy, in that case, the parathyroid gland will remain quiescent. It will remain inactive. It doesn't have any work. It works only when there is hypocalcemia. So this quiescent or a silent parathyroid gland cannot work to the fullest extent or as per the need of body at the time of calving. And therefore, there is slow mobilization of calcium from the gland, which in turn results into the hypocalcemia or a milk fever. High levels of phosphorus intake are also not desirable. They also affect the 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol levels and indirectly decreases mobilization. The factor which is dietary factor, which is gaining importance in recent period, is the cation or anion part of ruminant diet. So the diet which is rich in cations like sodium and potassium cause decreased absorption as well as they are also responsible for the decreased mobilization of calcium from the bone. So animal as well as dietary risk factors, they are responsible for this milk fever. But in nutshell, I would like to conclude that the excess loss of calcium through colostrum beyond the capacity of body to mobilize the calcium from the bone is responsible for milk fever. Milk fever is very easy to diagnose. I know that the senior veterinarians they can easily diagnose the milk fever condition. And generally, history of parturition and high milk yield, these are the criteria which are being considered for the diagnosis. Here I would like to share that the disease is very common in exotic animals, high yielding buffaloes. Particularly Zafarabadi buffaloes, they are considered more susceptible, and among the exotic breeds, Jersey breed is more susceptible as compared to the Holstein Friesian. Although Holstein Friesian, they are producing more milk. It has been mentioned in the literature that Jersey cows, they produce more milk as compared to their body size or per unit surface of the body. This is one thing which increases susceptibility of the Jersey cows to the milk fever. Disease mainly occurs at the three stages of lactation. So this is helpful for diagnosis. 3% of the cases, they are being observed few days before calf. 6% cases, they are occurring during the process of parturition, whereas 91% cases, they occur during postpartum period, that is after calf. As for the distribution of these 91% cases during postpartum period is concerned, 75% of the cases, they are occurring within first 24 hours. So out of 100 cases, 75 cases, they are occurring within 24 hours after parturition. 12% cases, they are occurring within 24 to 48 hours. And very few, that is 4% cases, they are occurring 48 hours after calf. So this is important from the diagnosis point of view. Here I would like to share, although the danger period for a milk fever extends from 1 week before calving to 1 week after calving, the cases may occur at any stage of lactation or even during advanced pregnancy also. But those are rare, and where usually the predisposing factors, they are responsible for hypercalcemia. The signs of signs observed in the milk fever are very typical, and they develop in the three different stages. The first stage, that is the stage of excitement. During this stage, animals, they are standing and they show somewhat incoordination and tremors. Body temperature is normal. This phase lasts for half an hour. Very rarely, veterinarians get chance to observe the case during this stage. Generally, the cases are being presented to us during the second stage, that is the stage of sternal recumbency. During this stage, usually the body temperature is subnormal, skin and extremities, they are cold, and animal, it is sitting on the sternum, resting its head on the ground or turning the neck or head towards the flank. Defecation is absent, urination is absent, muzzle is dry, and usually the bloat starts developing. Third stage, or the stage of lateral recumbency. During this stage, the animal is laterally recumbent, and therefore during this stage, animal is likely to develop tympany. Sometimes regurgitation may occur. Aspiration pneumonia is also likely to develop during this stage. The body temperature is extremely subnormal, may go below 95 degree Fahrenheit. It is sometimes difficult to raise the even this jugular vein. And finally, animal dies because of the circulatory failure. The blood can be collected and the diagnosis of milk fever can be confirmed in the laboratory based on a low serum level. But cases of milk fever are emergency type of cases and we'll have to execute the treatment immediately. We cannot wait for the results of laboratory. But definitely, the serum calcium level help us in a confirmative type of diagnosis. Under the field conditions, the response to the calcium therapy, dramatic response to the calcium therapy, helps in confirmation of the diagnosis. mill fever cases, they must be differentiated from the calving injury. So calving injuries, they are developing at the time of calving only. And therefore, many people, many veterinarians, they get confused with the different types of the calving injuries.
Sir, your screen is lost.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Screen is lost.
No, it is visible.
Okay.
It is visible.
Okay. So the calving injuries, they develop because of handling of the animal for a prolonged period for a dystocia that usually results into the sciatic nerve paralysis, obturator nerve paralysis. The animals, they may fall down during the first stage of milk fever because of incoordination, or during the recovery period when they make attempt to get up immediately after giving calcium, they may fall down on a slippery floor and they may suffer from the fracture, tearing of the tendon, and paralysis. So in such type of the cases, usually body temperature is normal, appetite is normal, means animal is clinically all right. Only animal is unable to get up, and there will be no response to the calcium therapy. Now, next disease or a condition needs to be differentiated, that is toxemia. Toxemia is also very common at the time of calving, and it occurs because of metritis resulting from retention of placenta, mastitis, sometimes even traumatic reticuloperitonitis develops at the time of calving because of penetration of the foreign body through the reticulum owing to the labor pains of parturition and indigestion. So this particular condition is also characterized by subnormal body temperature, like a milk fever. But here, one differentiating feature is present, that is congestion of mucous membrane. Otherwise, the signs of toxemia and the signs of milk fever are almost similar. Second important point, which helps in the differential diagnosis, is the response to calcium therapy. So in toxemia, there is no response. In hypocalcemia or milk fever case, there is a good response to the calcium therapy. Ephemeral fever rarely occurs, but if it occurs at the time of calving, it needs to be differentiated. And it can be very well differentiated based on history of fever or evidence of fever, accompanied by lameness, followed by recumbency. Because some cases of ephemeral fever also present a picture like a milk fever. They become recumbent. And in ephemeral fever also, there is a mild hypocalcemia, and those cases may respond to calcium therapy, may show some response to the calcium therapy. But good response to analgesic, that is a characteristic feature, and the history of fever, that helps in the differential diagnosis. Next condition which needs to be differentiated, actually acidic indigestion results into finally toxemia. But I have taken it separately. I want to discuss it separately because acidic indigestion is very common at the time of calving in Indian animals. Because in our country, most of the farmers in the villages, they are not giving concentrate to their animals during advanced pregnancy. And immediately after calving, the farmers, they are giving crushed grains or whole grains, particularly boiled grains, to their animals. So when exhausted animals get good amount of or a large amount of grains, boiled grains, they suffer from a ruminal dysfunction or a digestive disturbance. So that may result into toxemia. That may also result into hypocalcemia. And animals, they present a picture sometimes like a milk fever. These cases also show some response to calcium therapy, but they do not completely recover unless they are given a large amount of Ringer's lactate-like fluid or unless they are given purgatives or laxatives. The next condition which I would like to discuss with all of you, cholesterol-induced indigestion. I think this particular problem we have encountered in our area, and I also came to know from most of the veterinarians that the colostrum is being fed to the recently cured animal. Actually, colostrum is meant for calf, but some farmers, they are giving surplus colostrum to their dams, maybe a buffalo or cow. In our area, it is a common practice in buffaloes. So when this colostrum is fed to the recently cured animals, that results into the typical indigestion, which we have observed. We have conducted a very systematic studies on this colostrum-induced indigestion at our college. And we have came to the conclusion that this colostrum-induced indigestion is usually alkaline in nature. Sometimes it is maybe a simple type of indigestion. It depends upon the quantity of colostrum fed. I have seen and observed that 2 to 5 kg of colostrum is being fed to the buffaloes. This particular condition is characterized by anorexia, congested mucosae, absence of defecation, but the most typical signs, they include, here you can very well see that congestion is more marked. This is because of toxemia. And the affected animals, they show incoordination also. They show loss of balance. They show unilateral deviation of neck, like a listeriosis. But that may be on either side. So these animals, they walk even in the circles. They appear like a dummy type of syndrome. And even they don't bother for us. As if those animals are not. So these are the typical signs. If the animals, they are tied very close to the wall, then usually animals, they keep their head against the wall. Even sometimes they stretch the rope. So these type of the typical signs are observed in colostrum-induced indigestion. Wherever and where you will get a history of feeding of the colostrum. Sometimes these animals will also become sternally recumbent or laterally recumbent. And when they are sternally or laterally recumbent, they present a picture like a male fever. In some animals, we have also seen violent convulsions, but those are very rare. We have developed this treatment protocol for colostrum-induced indigestion. We have treated more than 20 cases with this particular protocol. That includes the DNS, 3 liters every 6 hours on a first day. Generally, we used to monitor the cases every 6 hours for first 24 hours, which are very critical. In mild to moderate cases, you can repeat it after 12 hours. Severe cases, yes, they need to be given fluid every 6 hours. Single dose of calcium, magnesium, and phosphorus preparation, Mifex-like preparation can be given so as to take care of mild hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and hypophosphatemia due to indigestion. Vitamin B1, B6, B12, that needs to be given for 5 to 7 days. CPM for 3 days. We are generally using laxatives, probiotics, and oral antibiotics to promote the defecation, to prevent the unwanted fermentation, and to provide the flora. So this is being given once the animal is able to swallow the food. Because in the beginning, I have seen for first 24 hours, generally lockjaw type of condition also develops. And we are unable to open the mouth and we are unable to give even oral preparations. But once animal is able to open the mouth, we can give laxatives, probiotics, and oral antibiotics for 3 days to stop unwanted fermentation in the GI tract. In a severe cases, we have to use steroids, and even we have used diazepam 0.15 to 0.25 milligram every 6 hours. Generally, 3 to 4 doses of diazepam during first 24 hours, they are sufficient. And next day, generally, there is a good recovery from the nervous sites. But these two things needs to be used only in severe cases, very severe type of the cases. Again, the topic of interest is Downer-Cow syndrome. So it is a very vast topic, but here I would like to share 2 or 3 slides of Downer-Cow syndrome. Downer-Cow syndrome is considered as a complication or a sequel of the and this Downer-Cow syndrome is a number of reasons. persistent hypocalcemia, persistent hypophosphatemia. These are the two important reasons because it is a complication of hypocalcemia. Second is a persistent hypophosphatemia. Hypomagnesemia may also contribute when it is accompanied as an accompaniment to hypocalcemia. Then hypokalemia. Actually, hypokalemia is not a primary one, and it is a result of recumbency. Because of prolonged recumbency, there is a muscle damage, cellular damage, and release of potassium ions, which are intracellular in nature. And those potassium ions, they are excreted through the urine, and that is resulting into hypokalemia and again weakness. Muscular injury is common due to recumbency, and particularly in heavyweight animals. Then nerve injuries, they develop because of again recumbency, prolonged handling for dystocia, that may also contribute. Then fractures of hip, limb bones, and dislocation of the joints. Many times, this is the reason for a downer. And it develops because of falling of the animal while getting up. Usually, there is a spreading of the legs on a slippery floor. Then myocarditis, which may develop because of repeated dosing with calcium preparate. When case is not responding, we are giving calcium frequently. And that may result into myocarditis. In fatty animals, when they become anorectic, the fatty cow syndrome develops, hepatosis will develop, the mastitis, acidic indigestion, colostrum indigestion, metritis, and even TRP may lead to recumbency owing to toxemia. Whenever we get any recumbent animal, we should classify into 2 categories, alert downers and non-alert downers. So alert downers, they are alert and bright. They are clinically all right. Appetite is normal, body temperature is normal, heart rate is normal, mucous membranes are very normal, everything is normal. But animals are either sternally recumbent, usually sternally recumbent, and they may attempt to get up in the initial stage. This particularly alert Downer-Cow syndrome is observed due to calving injury, that is hip load dislocation, fracture, tearing of the tendons, paralysis, etc. So here everything normal, only animal is unable to get up, particularly the hind portion. Non-alert Downer syndrome, in case of non-alert Downer-Cow syndrome, animals, they are dull and depressed, they don't take feed and water, body temperature is usually subnormal, tachycardia is observed, conjunctivae or the mucous membranes are congested, and animals, they are usually unable to sit or unable to adopt sternal recumbency. They are in the lateral recumbency and they doesn't make any attempt to get up or rise because they are very much dull and depressed. And this particularly condition is observed in a toxemia due to metritis, a severe type or periacute type of mastitis, maybe due to TRP, and most commonly due to indigestion next to metritis. Now the treatment of milk fever. Everybody is treating cases of milk fever successfully with the calcium salts. But when we talk about the dose is not set. It is not fixed, but many workers, they have mentioned that it needs to be given at the rate of 1 ml per kg body weight or 1 gram of active ionic calcium per 45 kg of the body weight. each 100 ml of Calborol contains 1.86% of calcium. So accordingly, we'll have to calculate the dose. Always treatment is effective if it is given in the initial stage. Apart from this calcium therapy, good nursing, good care of recumbent animal is important for complete recovery and for prevention of Downer cow syndrome. Improper care of the animal is the main reason for the Downer cow syndrome in many, many animals. Those who have treated the cases, they might have seen a dramatic response to the calcium therapy in cases of milk fever. The response is excellent. Once we start giving fluid therapy, calcium therapy, the animals will show the eructation, muzzle will appear moist, then the salivation will start. Animals usually they defecate, heart intensity of the heart sound gets increased, heart rate slows down, and animal stands up quickly on its balance immediately after completion of calcium therapy. 60% is observed that 60% of the cases, they recover immediately after discontinuation of the calcium therapy. 15% cases, they take 2 hours, and 10% cases, they recover. Usually they take 6 to 8 hours for recovery. 15% cases, they don't recover. They either require disposal or they die. So during the course of treatment, animal defecates, animal makes attempt to get up and gets up immediately after the treatment. Some cases of milk fever, it is one of the challenging problems faced by the field veterinarians, that some cases of milk fever, they fail to respond, or some cases show relapse of milk fever. So it has been observed in 10 to 30% cases. The reasons for failure or relapse, they include delay in treatment. If the case, the ideal situation is a treatment during first stage, but we don't get cases during first stage, we'll have to treat the cases during at least second stage, we'll have to make attempt to treat the cases during second stage or in the initial part of the third stage. So delay in treatment. Next is underdosing. Because of fear of calcium toxicity, sometimes we give little dose and that may result into incomplete recovery. And even this is one of the reasons for Downer cow syndrome. The concurrent hypophosphatemia, we give calcium, but if there is hypophosphatemia, there will be a tiredness, there will be a muscular weakness, and animal will not recover. Hypomagnesemia also contributes to incomplete recovery or relapse. Vitamin D deficiency, whenever we are giving the ionic calcium, the blood calcium level will be restored, it will be maintained, but it will be maintained for a short period of maybe 12 hours or like that. During next milking, once the colostrum, again the colostrum is being drawn, the calcium level will go down unless the bone metabolism is restored. And for restoration of the calcium metabolism or bone metabolism, vitamin D should be present in the body in adequate quantity. So vitamin D deficiency will lead to impaired metabolism and recurrence of the milk fever. Old animals, they are more prone to relapse or more, you can say, their recovery is less. They take more longer recovery period or recurrence is possible. Because the number of receptors in the digestive system for vitamin D, they goes down, and absorptive efficiency of digestive tract is reduced, and therefore calcium homeostasis cannot be maintained. Now, how to increase success rate in a milk fever cases? Early treatment. So this is required as far as possible. But many times this is not in our hand. Once the case is reported to us, we'll have to execute the treatment. Give proper doses of calcium. Already we have discussed about the calcium doses. Third, we can give phosphorus and magnesium preparations along with calcium. My mentor and guide, Professor Bhup Singh sir, used to tell us that for heavyweight animals, for a Mura buffaloes, one bottle of calcium and one bottle of, you see my effects like preparation, helps in a complete recovery from a milk fever, and also helps in a prevention of a recurrence of the milk fever. injections of vitamin D3 can be given along with this calcium therapy. That will help in prevention of relapse or recurrence of the milk fever. Very recently, one veterinarian reported me about the relapse of milk fever every 24 hours. Four times the milk fever was reoccurred in a single case. So in such type of the cases, we'll have to give thought for use of vitamin D and even the phosphorus and magnesium preparation. Calcium does magic. The actually calcium treatment of milk fever cases gives name and fame to the veterinarian. But on the other side, calcium sometimes proves dangerous to the animal, may cause case fatality, and a veterinarian has to face a very piquant situation if animal dies, a healthy animal, while giving calcium if it dies in the trips. So we should know what are the causes of calcium toxicity, which includes the human factors and the animal factors, overdosing of calcium, rapid administration of calcium. Sometimes we are in a hurry and we want to finish that bottle and therefore we give it very rapidly. So that should not be done. Repeated administration, already I told, it contributes to chronic toxicity. Animal factors, toxemia. When the mucous membranes are congested, how to identify toxemia? Congestion of mucous membrane. If it is there, in that case, we should always administer calcium slowly. We should monitor the case. Then excessive excitement. Some animals are very timid, and because of fear, they collapse and die. So please allow the animal to calm down. While tying, while restraining the animal, animal gets excited. On one side, if it is excited, and on the other side, if you are pushing the calcium in hurry, that animal is likely to suffer from a calcium toxicity. So allow the animal to settle, calm down, and then you start giving the calcium. How to prevent the calcium toxicity? How to treat? If you see the adverse signs of calcium toxicity, immediately you give atropine sulfate. 1 ml per 20 kg body weight, and usually 15 to 20 ml of calcium, you can give it by intravenous.
Please continue, sir. You are by mistake on mute.
Okay.
Please.
I am audible. So how to prevent the calcium toxicity? So this is important from our point of view. And for prevention of calcium toxicity, give proper dose of calcium. Animals should be calm and quiet. Administer calcium slowly and monitor the calcium therapy. Monitor the patient. And it is suggested that one bottle of calcium should be given in 20 minutes. So if you are an advisor for a farm, in that case, you are expected, or we are expected, to advise the farmer for a control of milk fever. Milk fever can be prevented to great extent if we manipulate the nutrition and if we make improvement in the management practices. No doubt, the heredity is one of the predisposing factor for a milk fever. There are so many other factors which are in our hand, which can be controlled, and the milk fever can be prevented. Provide simply, you see, during winter, don't keep the animals in open. Provide them good shelter. It will reduce the chances of cold stress. In summer also, heat stress may result into hypocalcemia. I have seen several pregnant animals, they showed signs of hypocalcemia due to heat stress, and they responded to calcium therapy quickly. So either it is a cold stress or a heat stress. Heat stress has not been mentioned anywhere in the literature. That may result into the hypocalcemia. Give exercise to the advanced pregnant animal. That is most important. That will keep the GI function active So the absorption will be good. Bone metabolism will remain active, and the animal will be able to mobilize the calcium at the time of carving. So giving exercise during advanced pregnancy is very important. Avoid long distance transportation of animal during the advanced pregnancy. It is a very bad practice in most parts of our state and country that the animals, they are being transported during advanced pregnancy, they are being sold during advanced pregnancy, and I have seen that is the factor for precipitation of milk fever cases. Vitamin D3 is the best measure for prevention of milk fever, even under the field conditions and on a hard basis also. Giving vitamin D3 at the dose rate of 20,000 international units per kg body weight intramuscularly 1 week before calving is highly effective. It should be given 3 to 7 days before expected date of calving. It provides 80% protection by increasing calcium absorption. It is better to give roughages to the animal just before parturition, or animals which are about to parturate, because roughages, and that too dry roughages, will keep digestive tract active and the digestive disturbances will be minimum. Generally, in the field and even farmers, they are interested in giving ionic calcium to their animals immediately after calving. And I think this is the very common control measure used under the field condition. But here, we are giving calcium in a large dose. And I have come across with reports and feedback from field veterinarians, and personally also I have observed in some cases, calcium therapy has resulted into reduced milk production. Although the calcium is given for increasing the milk production, it has led to a reduction in the milk production, probably due to administration of high doses of calcium, resulted into calcium phosphorus imbalance in the body. That could be the reason. So ARD system of dose fixation should be used under the field condition. It's very easy. ARD system that is based on appetite, ruminal motility, and defecation. If appetite, ruminal motility, and defecation of the animal, if everything is normal, in that case, give just 110 ml of calcium. Means if you are giving calcium to healthy animals, one bottle is sufficient for 4 animals. If there is a reduction in either appetite, ruminal motility, or defecation, give 225 ml of calcium, half bottle. And if all parameters are severely depressed, means when the case is going towards the milk fever, minimum 330 ml of calcium borogluconate is to be given. Alternative to this, which is somewhat easier and less risky, and you will get more persistent and consistent results with diketonic calcium preparations, like Caldi-12, Macalvit, Sancalvit, any preparation which contains diketonic calcium plus vitamin D3 can be very well used. 3 doses at the rate of 15 ml in a week, maybe on a first day, fourth day, and seventh day. That will take care of hypocalcemia during the first week after calving. Oral calcium preparations are also effective, and we should educate the farmers for oral calcium preparations. The calcium gel, now it is easily available. Many of the companies, they are manufacturing, so that can be very well used. Maybe 6 to 12 hours before calving and 6 to 12 hours after calving, 2 doses of calcium gel will definitely help in prevention of the milk fever. This can be used as an alternative to ionic calcium also. Let us train for prevention of hypocalcemia is a DCAP concept. This is directed towards a regulation of dietary cation anion balance. So ruminant diet contains cations like sodium and potassium, which are alkaline in nature, and anions like chloride and sulfate, which are acidic in nature. So there should be a balance between these cations and anions. If the diet is rich in cations, it will be alkaline type of the diet. It will adversely affect the absorption of calcium from the GI tract. Even the pH of the blood will be affected to little extent, and the calcium homeostasis will be affected. And therefore, feeding of anionic supplement during advanced pregnancy or at the during the risk period is advised. In old days, ammonium chloride and ammonium sulfates, they were being given, but they are unpalatable. They reduce the dry matter intake of the animal during the critical period, and therefore they are not much effective. But new generation products with more palatable carriers, they are now available in the market. Those can be very well used for the prevention purpose. So this is all about the fever. The second important disease, which is observed under the field condition, that is bovine ketosis. It is a disease. It is a metabolic disease of high yielding adult dairy cows and buffaloes. Occurs during early lactation, that is 2 to 8 weeks after calving. This particular ketosis occurs in two different forms, that is a clinical ketosis and a subclinical ketosis. Clinical ketosis is again a sporadic. Sometimes its incidence may go up to 6% on a particular farm. And the incidence of subclinical mastitis, particularly in high yielding animal, proves detrimental to the economy of the animal owners. And its incidence is approximately 50% on a farm where high yielding animals they are being kept. This disease is economically important. Everybody knows that disease doesn't cause mortality. Very rarely bovine ketosis causes a mortality. Usually it is responsible for heavy production losses. The milk production decreases by 25 to 100%. This is the main, you can say, the economic loss. But apart from this, ketosis increases the incidence of retention of placenta, particularly negative energy balance, which is very common at the time of calving or during periparturient period, increases the incidence of retention of placenta, increases the incidence of vasal displacement, even mastitis. And if a subclinical or clinical ketosis occurs during the postpartum period, definitely it is going to affect the postpartum estrus. It will be delayed, conception rate will be reduced in affected animals. And so ketosis is a multifactorial type of disorder of energy metabolism. And we all know that ketosis, it results from a negative type of energy balance. And this negative energy balance is mainly due to feeding of low carbohydrate diet to the lactating animals, high yielding animals, if they receive a low carbohydrate diet, which results into formation of less amount of propionic acid in the rumen and hypoglycemia. When this low carbohydrate diet is coupled with a high milk yield, then ketosis results. Therefore, it's considered as a multifactorial disorder. Milk contains, you all know that milk contains 4.5% of the lactose. That means through every kg of milk produced, the animal is losing 45 grams of lactose. If a cow is yielding 30 liters of the milk, means she will be losing a lot of, the glucose, maybe around 1.5 kg of the glucose in the form of lactose. This is the another important cause. The third cause, that is the overfeeding of protein-rich concentrates. Overfeeding of protein-rich concentrates, actually proteins, feeding of protein increases the milk yield for a time being. But finally, overfeeding of protein-rich concentrate may result into negative energy balance and ketosis. Protein-rich concentrates, usually they increase the butyric acid production or ketogenic acid production. The fourth important factor, which may gain importance in a near future in our country as well as in even Maharashtra also, that is excess feeding of silage. Silage production is increasing. So, and feeding of excess amount of silage may lead to even ketosis, because silage contains 2 to 4% of the butyrate. The deficiency of the phosphorus and cobalt may not primarily cause ketosis, but definitely they contribute to ketosis by disturbing, you see the energy metabolism. Phosphorus as well as cobalt, they are involved in the energy metabolism. So here, in just one line, I would like to conclude the etiology of ketosis, that ketosis occurs in high-yielding cows and buffaloes during early lactation, particularly those animals which are maintained on a low carbohydrate diet and yielding very high. Lack of exercise, heredity, cold climate may also contribute to the ketosis. Hormonal factors, particularly stress hormones like adrenocortical insufficiency, may also contribute to the this particularly ketosis. Loss of appetite is usually responsible for a secondary type of ketosis. Diseases which are occurring during the postpartum period, like metritis, pneumonia, traumatic reticuloperitonitis, the indigestion, they are responsible for anorexia and low energy intake, resulting into ketosis. Even Sara and Theileriosis, they are important. We have seen buffaloes suffering from Sara during the early lactation usually exhibit the symptoms of ketosis. Cows suffering from Theileriosis during the postpartum period usually exhibit the signs of Theileriosis, signs of ketosis. The diagnosis of ketosis is very easy. Ketosis is to be diagnosed based on the history of recent calving, high milk yield, lack of nutritive feed. Usually we get history of feeding of less amount of concentrate to high yielding animals. And therefore, feeding history is very important in the diagnosis of ketosis. Lack of nutritive feed, maybe a poor quality roughages, only cereal roughages, that to poor quality roughages. No concentrates or feeding of less amount of concentrate. Overfeeding of protein-rich concentrates like oil cakes. I have seen some of the enthusiastic farmers, particularly buffalo owners, they are giving only oil cakes to their buffaloes during early lactation for getting more milk. So in those cases, usually ketosis occurs. Then the ketosis develops in occurs in two different forms. Most common form, that is a wasting form, which is seen in 90% cases. The second form, that is a nervine form or a nervous form, which is occurring in 10% cases. So the most common is a wasting form. You can see the loss of body weight, rapid loss of body weight. Within 3 or 4 days, you can see emaciation. Second, the fall in milk yield is very drastic. These two signs, they are observed, but they are not diagnostic. The diagnostic sign is a selective appetite, that is a refusal of concentrate. One can diagnose a case of ketosis just by noting this particular sign. Animal continues to eat dry roughages, greens, but shows a disinclination or disinterest in concentrates. Sweety smell to the breath may be observed if we are very closely examining the animal. In that case, sweety smell to the breath and even sweety smell to the urine can be noticed. The cases of ketosis can be confirmed in the laboratory by noting hypoglycemia, ketonemia, ketonuria. Rothera's test is a very good bedside test which can be used for screening the animal on a hard basis. It is easy, simple reagents are required and can be made easily available. Glucose estimation can be done in any pathology lab and the disease can be confirmed. The response to the treatment is confirmative under the field conditions where laboratory facilities are not available. The differential diagnosis of a wasting form of ketosis. Actually, here we are going to discuss the diseases which usually result into a secondary type of ketosis and creates a confusion. So first is a traumatic reticulitis, In case of traumatic reticulitis, there is a tympani with arching of the back, recurrent tympani with arching of the back, X-ray, foreign body, vagus indigestion, typical papal shape distension, half papal, and chronic moderate frothy bloat. X-ray examinations reveal either foreign body or hernia. Traumatic pericarditis, which is characterized by fever, and the most important sign is the engorgement of the jugular vein and the brisket edema. Splashing or heart sounds, very easily pericarditis can be diagnosed even before appearance of the brisket edema by doing the auscultation and noting a typical, you can say, the pericardial rub and even a splashing sound. X-ray examination reveals foreign body in the chest. In these diseases, usually the Rothrock test is positive and animals show even signs of ketosis. Then pneumonia and pleurisy is also very common in buffaloes and crossbred animals during postpartum period, which is characterized by chest pain, coughing, nasal discharge, abnormal lung sounds. Then metritis is also very common during first 2 weeks. Primary cases of ketosis usually doesn't develop within first 15 days or 2 weeks. If signs of ketosis are observed during first 2 weeks of calving, then usually those are due to either metritis or due to foreign body syndrome. That is my common observation. So in metritis, you will get a history of retention of placenta, dystochia, prolapse, and you can notice a prolonged vaginal discharge. Sometimes it is not noticed by the farmers, but on pararectal examination, you may find a swollen uterus and widening of vaginal discharge. Thalidiosis is very common during the early postpartum period because the early lactation, stress of parturition is a predisposing factor, a risk factor for thalidiosis. So you will get a cases of subclinical thalidiosis or even clinical thalidiosis during the postpartum period. Very interesting combination I have seen in a crossbred animals, and which is very important from a field veterinarian point of view or a field point of view. The management of all those diseases is needed. I have seen a combination of thalidiosis, metritis, and a ketosis. Actually, metritis is the main cause in those cases. Usually, metritis leads to stress, thalidiosis, metritis leads to anorexia and ketosis. So in such type of the cases, unless we treat the animal for metritis and thalidiosis, animal will not recover from ketosis. Another interesting combination we have seen in a buffaloes. Buffaloes, they are prone to subclinical type of SARA, a mild type of SARA, and usually the signs of SARA, they are precipitated near parturation and particularly during the postpartum period when there is a stress of milk yield. So in those cases also, we generally found the combination of metritis, SARA, and the ketosis. Here, just I would like to share my personal experience. The cases of ketosis, we were treating. Those were responding to, the glucose therapy, but they were showing relapse. When the blood smear were examined, we could find the trips. And when the treatment for SARA was given, the animals, they recovered completely. So it is necessary to correct metritis. It is necessary to treat the animal for SARA. And if it is a crossbred, thalidiosis, then only there will be a recovery. The another interesting topic I would like to discuss as a part of differential diagnosis, that is a diabetes mellitus. It is a rare condition. It has been reported by many workers in the pets or dogs and cats. But there are very few reports of diabetes mellitus in large animals. Personally, I have come across with 13 cases of diabetes mellitus in cattle and buffaloes. And in general, in cattle, we have seen the signs of loss of progressive loss of body weight, polydipsia, increase in the thirst, water intake. Animals, they are drinking very large amount of water and they are voiding a large amount of urine, just like a human beings with a loss of body weight. Biochemical examination, hyperglycemia and ketonuria, they were evident. Here, this positive ketone Rothrock test, just like a ketosis. But here we find hyperglycemia. This is an important differentiating feature. In ketosis, usually there is hypoglycemia with ketonuria, whereas in diabetes mellitus, it is hyperglycemia with ketonuria. It is so simple to make a differential diagnosis. Here, the animals, they are giving good response to insulin therapy. Here again, I would like to share that in buffaloes, we have recorded somewhat different types of the symptoms from that of cattle. In buffaloes, we didn't find polydipsia. We could notice only loss of appetite and loss of body weight. And very interestingly, no response to antibiotic, no response to multivitamins, no response to hemoprotozoan, anti-hemoprotozoan drugs. So in those cases, when the blood examination was carried out, urine examination was carried out, we came across with the cases of diabetes mellitus. The differential diagnosis of nervous form of ketosis, cases of ketosis, they occur very rarely, nervous form. Those needs to be differentiated from rabies. Here we get a history of rabid dog bite, then listeriosis. Here usually there is a fever and deviation of head and circulation. We are getting number of cases of listeriosis in our country. And those animals are typically showing fever in the initial stage, maybe for 2 to 3 days, followed by deviation of NED in a head to one side. And these animals show circling also. Then lactation tetany. We have less frequently come across with the cases of lactation tetany. So it develops in animals grazing on a green lush pasture. Lead poisoning, again, it's very rare, but this is also characterized by blindness, convulsions, head syndrome. And the nervous form of ketosis must be differentiated from chlorinated hydrocarbon poisoning. This, the poisonings, they are very common in our country. And here we get the history of access to the poison. The treatment of the ketosis, generally the correction of the glucose, blood glucose is required for getting recovery from ketosis. And we used to treat the cases of ketosis in three steps. Step one, that is to be followed in maximum cases. That is effective in maximum cases. That is the replacement therapy. Here, we'll have to give glucose 20% at the rate of 0.5 gram per kg intravenously. That is 100 ml per 40 kg body weight. 100 ml of dextrose, 20% per 100 kg body weight for 2 to 3 days. For adult animal, you can give 1 to 1.5 liter of glucose 20%, which is easily available in the market. If 40%, 50% preparations are available, those can be very well used. But this treatment needs to be continued for minimum 2 and usually for 3 days. Along with glucose, you can give a B-complex preparation. If the case doesn't show response to glucose therapy, you can add even steroid and you can go for a glucose 20% with dexamethasone, 0.04 milligram per kg. You can also use isoflupredenone, betamethasone can be used. Even triamcinolone acetonide can also be used. So any corticosteroid, glucocorticoid can be used along with glucose. 2 to 3 doses, they can be given. So this therapy is more effective than the glucose therapy alone. This is the observation of my guide and teacher, Dr. Anantwar sir, who did a PhD on this particular disease. The step three, that is the insulin therapy. This is required in very rare cases. Under exceptional circumstances. Is there any problem? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So step three, that is insulin therapy. Here, we are giving insulin to the ketotic buffaloes, ketotic cows. In unresponsive type of the cases, means the cases of ketosis which are not responding to glucose alone or glucose plus corticosteroid, this therapy is to be used. In case of chronic type of ketosis or a persistent type of ketosis, the ketone bodies, they are toxic to the beta cells of pancreas. They cause damage to the beta cells of pancreas and it adversely affect the release of insulin from the pancreas. And therefore, in persistent cases of ketosis, in the late stage, glucose level may be normal to slightly elevated with the ketonuria. So those cases actually need insulin. This therapy is quite effective. Insulin, which is used in human beings, that can be very well used, mixed type of insulin. It can be used at the dose rate of 0.5 units per kg, subcutaneously or intramuscularly, for 1 to 2 days. Before giving insulin, glucose therapy should be given. First, you'll have to give the glucose, and then you can give insulin, or simultaneously you can give insulin. This is all about the treatment of clinical cases of ketosis. Already, I have shared that 50% cases of subclinical ketosis, they are observed on many of the hearts where the management, particularly feeding management, is poor. So in those cases, we can use glucogenic precursors fortified with nicotinamide. There are several companies which are manufacturing the glucogenic precursors with nicotinamide, and they are available in the market. Those can be given as per the instructions of that particular company. This will avoid the repeated injections. The response is slow, and these type of preparations can be very well used by the farmers. No need of veterinarians. Supportive treatment is also important in case of ketosis, and that in those cases, usually we recommend liver extract with B-complex or B-complex type of preparation for stimulating the, you can say, the glucose metabolism. Second, that mineral mixture should be advised on a regular basis if it is not being fed to the animal. Ketosis can be very well controlled. Its incidence can be very well reduced on a farm by improving the feeding practices. The most important is the body condition score, and the cow should be neither thin nor overfat at the time of calving. If the cow is thin during the first 30 days, she will not be able to give the optimum milk, and she is likely to suffer from a negative energy balance and ketosis. The cows which are very fat at the time of calving, they are also likely to lose their fat very rapidly, resulting into ketosis. Therefore, the body condition should be optimum. Feeding is very important during the early lactation. We'll have to provide good quality roughages so that animal will get good amount of energy. Extra allowance of concentrate should be given at the rate of 1 kg of concentrate per 2.5 kg of the milk produced. The protein percentage should not exceed 16% in a high yielding animals, that too during early lactation, because high protein content of the diet may result into ketosis. Ground maize can be given as a supplement because ground maize contains alpha polymerized glucose, which is considered as a bypass starch or a energy. Finely ground roughages and cooked grains, they are beneficial because when they are given, the propionate production is increased. Cotton seed and soybean, they contain the natural bypass fat. Those can be given to the animals in a sufficient quantity as per the frequency of the production. Mineral and vitamin mixture should be given on a regular basis. The fats, particularly the bypass fat, can be given to the high yielding animals, because their body capacity is less, and we cannot provide the sufficient energy to the animal through their diet. In that case, the concentrated source of energy can be given to the high yielding animals during the early lactation. So bypass fat that is available in the market, so we can use it. Those preparations are highly palatable. They are 100% rumen bypass. They doesn't disturb microflora. Alternative to this is oils. Traditionally, oils are used, but oils should not be used more than 3% of the diameter, And usually oils, they are not protected, they are non-protected, and oils, they disturb the ruminal microflora, and therefore we don't recommend feeding of oils more than 3% of the diet for prevention of the ketosis. Encourage maximum feed intake to the high-yielding animals. For that purpose, we'll have to give the palatable feed so that animal will eat more. Avoid sudden changes in the diet. Give adequate exercise. It will promote the ketone body utilization. Protect from inclement weather. It will reduce the energy requirement. Selection of cows having a good feed capacity. And this is very important. There are some cows on a particular farm or the animal owners which are yielding very high, but their feed capacity, the body capacity is less. And these animals are, they frequently suffer from ketosis. So such type of the animals should be removed or culled from the farm. Glucose precursors can be used in problem hearts, or the animals which are known to suffer from, you can say the ketosis, you can give glucose precursors. Rothera's test can be used as a screening test for diagnosis of the ketosis. So the third disease, that is phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. Actually, this disease is termed as a postparturient hemoglobinuria in cows and even in countries abroad. But in India, we call it as a phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. So in countries abroad, it is occurring in cows only, and particularly during the postpartum period, and therefore it is called as a postparturient hemoglobinuria. But in buffaloes from Asian countries or maybe from Egypt, the disease is occurring during pregnancy, advanced pregnancy, as well as during early lactation. And therefore, the disease is called as phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. The species vulnerable to phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria are cattle and buffaloes. But I have highlighted buffaloes. Have seen that buffaloes, they are 10 times more prone to phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria than crossbred cows. Indigenous cows are less prone. Very few cases, or rarely you may find a case in an indigenous cows. So here cows postpartum period, that is 2 to 4 weeks after parturition, buffaloes advanced pregnancy, as well as during early lactation. This disease is also economically important because the animals, the case fatality rate is high if the cases, they are not treated in time. The convalescent period or recovery period is very long because once animal is anemic, it is going to take at least 3 weeks for complete recovery. And I have observed usually 4 weeks are required for regaining and restoration of the hemoglobin status of the animal. Marked drop in milk production and delayed postpartum estrus, abortions may occur in a pregnant animals. The incidence is 0.70% in indigenous, you see, in the local buffaloes at our institute. The disease was found to be very common during dry season. In some areas, it is more common in winter, particularly in hilly areas where dry fodder is only available during winter. Whereas in the areas where the rabi crops are being taken, greens are available during winter, usually the disease is noticed during summer. So this may vary from area to area. But I will say that the disease is more common during the dry season. The disease is more common in lactating cows, lactating buffaloes, as compared to pregnant buffaloes. That is our observation at Udgir. But at other places, higher incidence even in advanced pregnant animal has been reported. But here I would like to share the in areas where the disease is occurring during summer, the incidence is high in the pregnant animals. The areas where the disease is occurring more commonly during winter, the lactating animals, they were found to be more prone. This is related to the physiological status of animal and the feeding status of animal rather than the production status. The maximum cases, they were found during the first month. But here again, I would like to share that the cases, they were observed after 2 weeks of parturition. Very rarely we have recorded a case before 2 weeks of parturition. 2 to 4 weeks, that is the most dangerous period. 2 to 4 weeks after calving. And later on, the number of cases, they decrease. We have recorded cases even in the late lactation, 7 to 8 months after parturition also. Milk yield, it is related to milk yield certainly. Even our animals are very low yielding. We have recorded cases, maximum cases in high yielding buffaloes. The feeding pattern wise incidence is very important. This disease can be correlated primarily with the feeding status of animal. The animals which were receiving dry fodder, with a meager or very less quantity of concentrate, they were found to be prone to the phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria or postparturate hemoglobinuria. The animals which were getting ad lib quantity of greens, they were found to be least susceptible. So the etiology of this particular condition is concerned. The phosphorus deficiency name itself indicates that it is due to the deficiency of phosphorus in the diet. Forages grown on phosphorus deficient soil, they are deficient in phosphorus. But it is said that even the forages which are grown on phosphorus deficient, on a soil which is having optimum phosphorus, they are also deficient in phosphorus. Means naturally, hay, kadbi, straws, they contain less amount of phosphorus, whatever may be the phosphorus status of the soil. But here, I would like to share one important sentence from the McDowell's book, that most of the soils in the world, they are deficient in the phosphorus. The same is the situation in our country. In a very small area, the phosphorus is optimum in the soil. Otherwise, most of the soils in our country, they are deficient to highly deficient in the phosphorus. The other part, the soils from all over the world, they are mostly calcareous in nature. That means they are rich in calcium and they are poor in phosphorus. That is in general status. Drought conditions, they reduce the phosphorus content in the forage. Even heavy rains, they may cause leaching of the phosphorus, leaching of the calcium from the soil, particularly from the hill areas, and they reduce the calcium and phosphorus content of the diet. The impaired absorption of phosphorus may be due to wide calcium phosphorus ratio, vitamin D deficiency, excess of calcium, aluminium, ferrous and phytates in the diet, or digestive disturbances. Among all these factors, this calcium phosphorus ratio is important in hemorrhages from phosphorus deficiency point of view. In our study, we have recorded a very wide calcium phosphorus ratio, and that could be one of the reasons for phosphorus deficiency. The phytates, they are important in a small, you can say the simple stomach animal. They are not much important in ruminants, because ruminants, they are having enzyme phytase. So phytates may not create problem for assimilation of phosphorus as far as our ruminants are concerned. Next is the increased requirement of phosphorus, maybe due to heavy drain of phosphorus through milk. In general, in cows, it's 0.93. In buffaloes, maybe up to 1 gram per kg of the milk. If buffalo is yielding 15 liters of the milk, means he is losing 15 gram of the phosphorus through the milk. It's so high. It is very interesting why I'm saying that phosphorus deficiency is more widespread than the calcium deficiency. And it is, in my opinion, most important in our animals as compared to calcium deficiency, because the ratio of phosphorus and calcium is 2:1 in the diet. It is 2:1 in the blood. But in milk, it is almost 1.2:1. Means animals, they are losing more phosphorus in comparison to calcium intake. And therefore, phosphorus deficiencies are more widespread in general in a livestock and in Indian scenario. The increased requirement for development of fetus. In general, during advanced pregnancy, for growth of fetus, the requirement of phosphorus is increased by 50%. And therefore, in conclusion, I would like to say that advanced pregnant buffaloes maintained on dry refuges, maintained exclusively on dry refuges and exposed to cold climate are usually affected. Analysis of soil revealed that phosphorus is poor in our soil when it is less than 15 kg per hectare. The analysis of feed and fodder sample revealed very high calcium, 1.4% in Kadbi, and it is 0.07% phosphorus. So it is too less. Actually, the calcium requirement of the animal is 0.4 to 0.6% of the diet, and the phosphorus requirement of the animal is 0.2 to 0.3% of the diet. Means the Kadbi contains only 1/3 of the requirement, whereas the calcium it is 3 times surplus than the requirement. Dry grass, same picture, but leguminous forages or roughages, maybe like a soybean guli, which is abundantly available in our country, then arhar guli, or any leguminous straw, maybe a groundnut straw, they are usually good in phosphorus, they are good in calcium. Then the concentrates are very important. Usually the grains, they contain a good amount of phosphorus, and the cottonseed cake, groundnut cake, they contain 0.6%. So cakes, they are very good or a rich source of phosphorus to our animals. Brands, they are also very good source of phosphorus. The phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria is very easy to diagnose based on the clinical signs. That affected animals, they pass the red urine. Usually appetite is slightly reduced to absent. Animals, they are dull. The most important sign may be temperature. In 70% cases, I have seen that the body temperature is normal. In 15% cases, the body temperature is slightly elevated, and those cases may get confused by babesiosis. And in 15% cases, particularly those presented during winter, that too during cool hours of the day, they exhibited subnormal body temperature. And the cases which were presented during afternoon hours or evening hours in summer season, they exhibited somewhat higher body temperature. The straining while defecation was the another interesting and important sign, consistent sign. Coffee colored urine and the color of mucous membrane, it varies. Initially it is pink, later on it becomes pale, and in a very late stage it becomes ectaric. Here you can see the brown animal is passing coffee colored urine, pale mucous membranes, coffee colored urine in the test tube, and this is most typical, this is observed by the animal owners. In dead animals, usually this urine is coffee colored and kidneys they are blackish. The diagnosis is to be made based on history of advanced pregnancy, early lactation, exclusive feeding. But here I would like to share that the phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria may occur at any stage of lactation or at any stage of pregnancy. But mostly during advanced pregnancy, mostly during early lactation. Exclusive feeding of dry roughages, very less amount of concentrates, a dry season. The clinical findings already we have discussed. Clinical pathological examination reveals low amount of HB, PCV and TC values with hypophosphatemia, and on centrifugation, the urine is urine maintains its color. There is good response to the phosphorus treatment. In case of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria, animal passes a red urine, and therefore we must differentiate the diseases characterized by the red urine. So red urine in animal is due to two reasons. It is either due to hematuria or due to hemoglobinuria. So whenever we get a case of red urine, we must classify it into two categories based on these parameters. In hematuria, usually urine is red colored. Urine appears, if it is taken in the test tube or bottle, it appears somewhat opaque, supernatant. In hemoglobinuria, urine is coffee colored or brownish colored, and it appears somewhat transparent. When urine is centrifuged, in case of hemoglobinuria, there is a settlement of RBCs. Here you can see the settlement of RBCs. And in case of hemoglobinuria, the urine maintains color. Urine is uniformly coffee colored. Its color is not affected. Under field conditions where centrifuge machine is not available, just you keep the urine or in a bottle or maybe in a test tube undisturbed for half an hour to 1 hour on a platform. And after half to 1 hour, you just observe. In that case, you will find that the supernatant is becoming clear and clear, and the urine is darker and darker on a lower side. Whereas in case of hemoglobinuria, there will not be any change, and there will not be any strata formation in the color of urine in the test tube. So it is very easy to distinguish hematuria and hemoglobinuria, but many times in the field, the hemoglobinuria is mistaken as hematuria and it is being treated, or hematuria is being mistaken as hemoglobinuria. Wherever laboratory facilities are available, urine can be centrifuged and the sediment can be taken on the slide and it can be examined for red blood cells. So those are found in hematuria and hemoglobinuria. No red blood cells, only casts are observed. This is the indirect way which I follow. Sometimes when urine is not available, just to centrifuge the blood, here you will find that in case of hematuria, the plasma is, you see the normal color, it is a straw color, whereas in hemoglobinuria, because of hemolysis, the plasma is a reddish color. So these are the causes of hemoglobinuria. Among the different causes of hemoglobinuria, I consider that one must distinguish babesiosis from PPH, because both cattle and buffaloes, they are susceptible to PPH as well as babesiosis in general. Leptospirosis, then bacillary hemoglobinuria, water intoxication, snake bite, onion poisoning is also observed in some areas. Copper deficiency has also been reported from Punjab. Drug-induced anemia also sometimes occurs, very rarely. Isoimmune hemolytic anemia may sometimes be seen in a newborn animals after, you can say, ingestion of the colostrum. Hematuria, it is mainly caused by urinary calculi. Nephritis, cystitis. But in general, the calculi, they are responsible for nephritis. Calculi, they are responsible for cystitis as well as urethritis. So in general, field conditions, these four, five disease conditions, they are responsible.
Parua.
Uterine or vaginal bleeding may sometimes, get confused with the hematuria or hemoglobinuria. Next. Here, I would like to throw some light on the differential diagnosis of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria and babesiosis. Phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria is more common in buffaloes, 10 times more susceptible. Whereas, opposite is the situation for babesiosis. Very rarely, buffaloes, they were found to be affected with babesiosis. It is common in cattle. Here, evidence of tick infestation may help to some extent, but again, I would like to share, I have seen so many cases of babesiosis with negligible tick infestation, or even 25% cases, there was no tick infestation. So I don't, I would like to share that we should not rely upon only tick infestation. Stress of heavy workload in bullocks, I have seen so many cases in bullocks due to strenuous work. Sowing operation, plowing operations, they predispose the bullocks. High yield and climate, they also, climatic factors, they also predispose our animals, particularly the cows, to the babesiosis. The typical sign is a coffee-colored urine, but this is accompanied by fever, or this is preceded by fever. In case of PPH, I already shared that in 85% cases, there is no fever. In 15% cases, there may be rise by 1 degree Fahrenheit. But in babesiosis, usually in 70 to 75% cases, you will find coffee-colored urine with fever in indigenous animal. And in general, in crossbred animals, in all crossbred animals, you will find fever plus coffee-colored urine. Here, blood smear examination will help in confirmative diagnosis. And under field condition, good response to the diamenazine or imidacarb within 24 to 48 hours, that is, that helps in the confirmative diagnosis. You can see the slightly brownish and pale type of mucous membrane babesia affected animal. A blue luck passing a red urine suffering from babesiosis. Again, this passage of pesty pieces with a straining is a characteristic sign of the hobgoblin. Dullness and depression. This leptospirosis is prevalent in southern states, particularly. In the areas on the, you can see the seashore, and paddy growing, particularly states where waterlogging is there. Most of the reports they are from the Tamil Nadu. This is more common, particularly in encas. The animals they are exhibiting red urine, whereas in adult animals, usually the jaundice is observed. In young animals, the red urine is observed. Adult animals, jaundice is observed, and even pregnant animals, abortion occur during advanced pregnancy. Bacillary hemoglobinuria not reported so far. Water intoxication, you must have come across with cases of interesting cases of water intoxication in a crossbred calves. Farmers, they usually complain that their 4 to 8 month old calves, they are passing red urine after drinking of water. They are passing red urine within half an hour after drinking of a large amount of water. And when you take the history, generally you will get the information that those calves, they are drinking huge amount of water. So in those animals, usually that drinking of a large amount of water results into a dilution of blood, hypertonicity, and the lysis of RBCs and the hemoglobin. It is temporary. Animal pass usually a red urine once, and next urination is usually normal. And the treatment has been educated in the books also. Hypertonic salines, they have been recommended. Steroids, they have been recommended. But I never use steroids and hypertonic saline. And I think that there is no need of giving any treatment to these animals. Usually, we should recommend frequent watering of the cows. Water should be made available round the clock to the such type of the animals. That will solve the problem. If suppose we cannot provide water throughout the day, you can provide water at least 5 to 6 times in a day to such type of the animals, that in a limited quantity, so that this problem can be avoided. Onion poisoning has been reported from onion growing areas. Here also, occasionally, we are getting the cases, and we have managed the cases of onion poisoning in cattle as well as buffaloes. The onion poisoning presents a picture, clinical picture, very similar to phosphorus deficiency hemoglobin. Usually, we find a coffee-colored urine, normal to sometimes slightly elevated body temperature, maybe a tachycardia, pale mucous membranes. Signs are very similar. But here we get history of feeding of onions, as such a whole onions or onion leaves. That is usually followed by hemoglobinuria. In most of the cases, usually there is a history of feeding of large amount of onions, maybe for 1 day, 1 hour, 2 days, or sometimes 4 or 5 days, depending upon the quantity. Here, for the first time, we have tried antioxidant. As far as the pathogenesis is concerned, onion poisoning develops because of oxidative stress. So in view of oxidative stress, we've tried ascorbic acid in vitamin E and selenium for the first time some 12 years back. And we found that ascorbic acid and vitamin E and selenium therapy is very effective in onion poisoning. And usually there is a recovery within 4 to 5 days from the hemoglobinuria. Snake bite, sometimes, very rarely. I have seen more than 500 cases, and I have come across with very few cases of hemoglobinuria due to snake bite, maybe 2 or 3 only. And here it is easy to diagnose swelling on the muzzle and maybe on any leg, and there may be a bleeding from the site of bite. Good response to the polyvalent anti-snake venom. Hematuria occurs in animals primarily due to these 4 reasons, that is urinary calculi, which is the most important cause of hematuria in bullocks. In cows, buffaloes, it's a rare cause. So continuous or intermittent red urine is present. Then usually a normal body temperature is observed. Renal colic may be present. And red urine is intermittent. This is, in my opinion, very important. Red urine is intermittent. It may be occasional also. And the body temperature is normal. And on centrifugation, you will find red blood cells. Nephritis may occur. This is characterized by red urine, fever, and colic. And on palpation of kidney perirectally, there may be evidence of pain and enlargement. Cystitis is also characterized by passage of red urine, but here staining is more marked. Here, interesting is red urine at the end of micturition or urination. So cystitis, urethritis, and nephritis can be very well distinguished or differentiated by seeing or observing the urination. In case of nephritis, usually the urine is uniformly red. Since beginning to end, the urine is red. In cystitis, usually urine is red at the end of micturition. In the beginning, supernatant urine is coming and therefore it is clear. And in urethritis, the urine is red in the beginning and later on it is becoming clear. So just observation of urination, observation of animal while urination helps in the differential diagnosis of cystitis, urethritis, and nephritis very well. Then the anthrax may sometimes cause, very rarely, we may get chance to see the case of anthrax. I got opportunity to see one case of anthrax in which the red urine was present. Then the there may be hemorrhage from the vagina or uterus after parturition, immediately after calving, due to excess handling, rigorous handling, and vaginal injury. Again, in literature, nowhere the hematuria has been mentioned in a black water. And buffaloes, again, it is very rare. But we have recorded cases in buffaloes as well as large number of cases in the cattle. But as far as the urine is concerned, I have seen at least 3 cases of red urine due to black water in the cows. In snake bite, there are chances of both red urine, that is hematuria, as well as hemoglobinuria. Both chances, in some cases there is hemoglobinuria, some cases there is hematuria, but it is again very rare. The how to treat the cases of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. The hemoglobinuria can be very well treated with sodium acid phosphate. In old days, this was the drug which we were using till 2008, 2009, and 60 to 80 gram of sodium acid phosphate is to be administered as a 20% solution for minimum 2 and maximum 4 days. This drug is given rapidly, causes shivering, sometimes labor breathing, collapse, and death of animal. Some field veterinarians, they have recorded these type of the reactions and they reported me. But personally, I didn't come across, because I used to give the sodium acid phosphate. I was giving sodium acid phosphate very slowly to the animals, and I was monitoring the case. Now the buffer phosphorus preparation is available in the market. It is one of the safest preparation. Its pH is adjusted. Actually, the adverse reaction to sodium acid phosphate is attributed to the highly acidic pH of the sodium acid phosphate. Here in buffer phosphorus preparation, pH is adjusted to the blood and therefore it is safe. It contains sodium dihydrogen and disodium hydrogen phosphate, and pH is adjusted. In addition, it contains inosin and sodium pyruvate. They are also useful in utilization of the phosphorus by the red blood cells. It is to be given at the dose rate of 50 ml IV, minimum 2 and maximum 4 days. There is no need to give 5th dose. Maximum 4 doses are required. The recovery period is 96 hours, minimum 48 hours. Very rarely a case will recover with a single dose of sodium, this buffered phosphorus preparation. Minimum 2 doses, maximum 4 doses they are required. As per the dose is concerned, 50 ml is sufficient, but in very high yielding buffaloes, heavyweight buffaloes, particularly Murrah buffaloes, Jafarabadi buffaloes, you can give 100 ml IV on a first day. Then the alternative is organic phosphorus preparation, but I don't recommend, because it doesn't restore the inorganic phosphorus level in the blood, but it is effective. I have tried, and animals, they respond, but doesn't correct the serum inorganic phosphorus level. Ascorbic acid can be used as an antioxidant. It gives, you can say, the symptomatic relief from oxidative stress and stops the hemolysis. But I don't recommend it alone for the management of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria, because it doesn't correct basic biochemical defect, that is hypophosphatemia. Antifibrinolytic drugs have also been used by the research workers from the Hisar. Actually, the Hisar people, they have worked a lot on the hemoglobinuria, and they have tried several drugs in buffaloes. So these antifibrinolytic drugs can also be used. In my opinion, the supportive treatment is equally important. Many times we pay more attention to the primary treatment, but I am of the opinion that supportive treatment is equally important for getting a complete recovery in case of PPH and bringing the animals to the production and reproduction. So supportive treatment needs to be followed strictly. So dextrose for 20% can be used 1 to 1.5 liter daily for 3 to 5 days. So this is, in my opinion, should be used. It's mandatory because glucose and phosphorus, they are interdependent and they increase the utilization of each other. See, the dextrose, the phosphorus increases the utilization of dextrose by red cells, red blood cells, and vice versa. And therefore, dextrose is very much helpful in the management of hemoglobinuric cases. B complex should be given as hematinic. Iron preparations by oral route or parenteral route can be used. I generally prefer the oral route. You can use maybe whatever preparations they are available in the market. There are now oral preparations like Sharpuferol and 3D8 and preparations are available. Even boluses, they are available. Those can be used. But those drugs must be used for minimum 20 days. Then CBC should be done. If hemoglobin value is regained, then they should be stopped. Otherwise, they should be continued for another 10 to 15 days. Then blood transfusion can be very effectively used in a severe type of the cases. That is life-saving if the hemoglobin level goes below 4 gram per cent. Mineral mixture should be recommended, advised on a regular basis. It will provide phosphorus and it will maintain the phosphorus level in the body of animal so that the production and reproduction can be regained. So here you can see the hemoglobinuric urine samples. In urine samples in hemoglobinuric animals before and after treatment, then you can see the mucous membrane change in the mucous membrane after 20-25 days of treatment. Then we have tried blood transfusion. It's very easy under field conditions. So many people now they are doing. And now many of the field veterinarians, particularly from Maharashtra, they have made it a very simple technology under the field conditions. Dr. Chatter is doing good work in this regard. Here in our institute, we are doing this particular doing research work for the last 8 years. Two of our students, they are doing research on this. One has already completed. In brief, I will complete this fourth important metabolic disorder or deficiency disorder, what you can call it as. And this is also found in our country. In countries abroad, it is called as the CRIPS, milk leg, milk laminus, or ulricate, particularly in crossbred animals. In India, in Haryana and Punjab, this particular syndrome is called as the rheumatism-like syndrome, which is like a rheumatism in human beings. And in Maharashtra, it is popularly known as Urmodi. This particular disorder is characterized by softening of the bones. It is responsible for a marked drop in milk production, reduced fertility, long recovery period, and sometimes these animals, they show pica and suffer from a foreign body syndrome. Its incidence is double to that of post-parturient hemoglobinuria. And it is very common in areas where the traditional system of feeding and farming is being practiced. It is more common during the summer season. It is interestingly more common in lactating animals. 95% of the cases they were recorded in lactating animals. Only 5% cases they were found in pregnant animals. That too, the animals which were producing milk as well as pregnant. Again, the disease was found to be high in animals in the late lactation. Very few cases in the beginning, early or mid lactation. Most of the cases, they were in the late lactation. This is interesting. In general, metabolic diseases, they are common during early lactation, whereas this is the metabolic disease which is occurring during the late lactation. Being a chronic disease, it is occurring during the late lactation. Milk yield wise, again, high yielding animals, they are more prone. Feeding pattern wise, again, the animals which are maintained on the dry fodder, they are found to be more susceptible to the osteomalacia. Once the animals start getting green fodder during the rainy season, they start recovering. In general, in all animal species, osteomalacia is caused either by deficiency of calcium or deficiency of phosphorus or deficiency of vitamin D. These are the three reasons, either one or two. they result into osteomalacia. In human beings, generally it's calcium, vitamin D, they are responsible. In animals, it is osteomalacia. It is due to phosphorus deficiency. The study conducted at our institute indicated that osteomalacia is due to significantly low levels of phosphorus in the diet. Phosphorus was found to be less than 0.1%. High levels of calcium, that is greater than the calcium level, was found to be 1.33% in the diet, and extremely wide calcium phosphorus ratio, it is 20:1. Surprisingly, we have noticed even the calcium phosphorus ratio as wide as 42:1. This is the average calcium phosphorus ratio which we have recorded in our field study. Then the disease develops in a three different, I have classified actually the stages of this disease. So these stages are very important for a clinician to know from a diagnosis point of view. The first stage that is characterized only by loss of body weight. Animal is losing body weight. The milk production is usually maintained or slightly reduced. Appetite is also usually maintained. Water intake is reduced to some extent. Fertility is suboptimal, and animals, they show some disinclination to. So no characteristic signs they are observed during the first stage. If animal owner is keen in his observations, in that case only the case is noted or diagnosed, noticed during the first stage. During the second stage, the typical, somewhat typical signs they are observed, particularly you can very well see this shifting type of lameness. Then here also you can see that animal is very reluctant to move. Animal owner is pulling, but animal owner is not moving and showing some even lameness. So moderate lameness, shifting from one leg to another leg, that is characteristic. During the third stage, again, the signs are very characteristic. Animal shows the typical stiff gait, arching of back, initially lameness, that is followed by increase in the stiffness in the gait. It is becoming a progressive day by day. Arching of the back is also noticed. Then animal keeps on a knee. Here you can see animal is keeping on a knee. Here both. This animal was sitting on a knee for 5 minutes. This animal was also sitting on a knee. And here you can see legs are moving. Animal makes attempt to move one leg, alternating legs, and tries to get up. It takes a lot of time. This is called as a kneeling. This is a case of permanent deformity. The animal remained osteomalacic for 1 year, not treated, and so developed a permanent deformity. This animal didn't recover. Next slide. See here, the arched back posture is very typical. Here, interestingly, you can see the arching of the back is at the wither region. If we observe this particular sign, we can very well diagnose a case of osteomalacia. Here you can see the abduction of elbows, stiff gait, and arching of the back with loss of body weight. Kneeling, here you can see the abduction of the legs, how the animal is standing. Here also you can see the arching of the back. The biochemistry is important. Hematology is not much important. Usually normal values. Biochemically, there is severe hypophosphatemia. Normal phosphorus level is usually above 4.5 milligram. And here it is 1.9 milligram average. Slight hypocalcemia, serum alkaline phosphatase level is high. And this can be done in any laboratory, pathology laboratory, and diagnosis can be confirmed. Radiological examination reveals again osteomalacia softening of the bones. The diagnosis, actually radiological examination is very important in the differential diagnosis of this osteomalacia. The diagnosis of osteomalacia can be made based on the history of high milk yield, feeding of dry roughages. These two points, in my opinion, they are very important. And the dry season. So that's a coincidence, dry roughages and dry season. Initially emaciation, then lameness, stiff gait, then arching of back and difficulty while getting up, which increases progressively. Any clinical pathology, severe hypophosphatemia, radiographic, already we have discussed. Here, I would like to throw some light on the differential diagnosis. Many of the veterinarians, they get confused with DTRP. Even in the beginning of my career, I was getting confused with the DTRP. And I have seen that the some cases of osteomalacia, they were operated for TRP with no foreign body when the X-ray facility was not available. But here, see, in TRP, very important here, just I would like to bring your attention. Here you see the, this is, here you can see the abdomen also. Tenderness is there, but tympani is there. And arching of the back is marked on the lumbar region. That is the difference. Because in TRP, fever may or may not be present. Then recurrent tympani in 70% cases, impaction in 30% cases, there is marked loss of appetite and milk. In osteomalacia, loss of appetite and milk production is less marked. Stiff gait and arching of back is very characteristic in case of TRP as well as osteomalacia. But here I have mentioned two important things. In TRP, stiff gait and arching of back, same gravity and it is continuous till that foreign body enters into the chest cavity. In osteomalacia, it is a progressive one. Day by day, stiffness in the gait increases. Day by day, arching of the back increases. But in case of TRP, arching of the back and stiff gait, they are constant till that foreign body is piercing. Once it enters in the chest or once it is passed into the chest, the signs of pain, they are relieved. And this is accompanied by tympani as well as marked anorexia and drop in milk production. X-ray examination may reveal foreign body. One more interesting symptom I would like to share with all of you, that in TRP generally penetrating foreign body is there. And when its direction is towards the lower side, animal faces difficulty in sitting. And animal remains in a standing position for a long time. But in cases of osteomalacia, in 90% cases I have seen that animal faces difficulty while getting up. Whereas in TRP, animal faces difficulty while sitting. There are 10% exceptional cases in which you will find different types of the signs. Here X-ray examination may be helpful and slight or no response to antibiotic and phosphorus treatment. Sprain may get, you may also get confused with the case of sprain, particularly sprain, it is occurring in males and osteomalacia is very rare in males. Particularly clinical cases, they are very rare. So sprain is observed in males, in females also, if it is observed, then you may get confused. But here we'll get a history of jumping, falling, fighting. Onset is very sudden. In osteomalacia, it is a progressive, it takes 1 month. You see, onset is sudden, gait is stiff, and here, body temperature, appetite, activeness, alertness, those are not affected. Animal continues to eat. Animal faces difficulty while sitting as well as getting up and gives good response to analgesic and anti-inflammatory drugs. No response to the antibiotic treatment. Arthritis, swollen joints are observed. Fluorosis also presents similar picture. But there are certain bales, certain areas where the fluorine content in the water, soil, and feed is high. In those areas, only fluorosis is prevalent. And in those areas, yes, the fluorosis, cases of fluorosis and the osteomalacia, they are present more or less similar picture. But in affected areas, endemic areas, the cases, they are occurring in both the sexes. Here, the osteomalacia is common in females. Another is the, you see, the particularly the mottling and pitting of the teeth. That is typical of the fluorosis. That is absent in case of osteomalacia. The last is the treatment. So osteomalacic animal can be treated with mineral mixture, sodium acid phosphate, or a combination of buffered phosphorus preparation with mineral mixture. We have tried at least 6 treatments in case of osteomalacia, and we have seen that mild to moderate cases can be very well managed with only mineral mixture, 20 gram, any mineral mixture, 20 gram per 100 kg orally for 30 days. This is 2 to 3 kg of mineral mixture is required, minimum 3 kg. So on a day first, I used to advise at least 2 kg. And then sodium acid phosphate can be used. Many companies, they are coming with even the IP grade sodium acid phosphate that can be used at the dose rate of 20 gram. Generally 60 gram total dose, total 60 gram of sodium acid phosphate can be given on a regular basis for 1 month. Then the third line of treatment, in worst cases, severe cases, give somewhat rapid relief. So initially, for the first 3 or 4 days, we can give a buffered phosphorus preparation, dextrose 20%, and B-complex preparation. So that will rejuvenate the animal. Animal will become somewhat alert and active. And this can be accompanied by mineral mixture on a regular basis for 1 month. In some cases, maybe you'll have to continue the treatment for 40 days. But in general, I have seen the recovery starts on the 4th day. On 4th day, you can very well see improvement in appetite and water intake. By 8th day, you can see improvement in the skin coat. And by 15th or 16th day, you will find at least 50% reduction in the, you can say, difficulty in gait. In some animal, mild to moderate cases, usually they recover within 15 to 20 days. Whereas severe cases, they take 25 to 30 days for recovery. But I am of the opinion that we should continue treatment without any break for at least 1 month. And thereafter also, we should continue mineral mixture to these animals in order to prevent recurrence of the osteomalacia and in order to improve the milk production and improve the productive performance. Here you can very well see the marked improvement in the affected animals after treatment. Sodium acid phosphate, this is the case which I treated some 20 years back. Here you can see the how much weight this animal has gained after giving the treatment. Here also you can see the remarkable improvement. For prevention of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria, osteomalacia. Hello? Osteomalacia, regular provision of mineral mixture containing phosphorus according to the requirement of the maintenance and production is to be given. That 400 animal weighing 400 kg needs 13 gram of phosphorus, and for milk production, extra allowance of phosphorus should be given. Accordingly, the dose of mineral mixture should be calculated and given to the high-yielding animals for prevention of phosphorus deficiency problems. Then provision of adequate quantity of concentrates and greens. We cannot provide a sufficient amount of phosphorus to the affected animals through roughages only. Concentrates are essential. So provide concentrates, and the phosphorus level of the soil can be increased by application of superphosphates at the rate of 125 kg per hectare. That will help in improving the phosphorus status of the forages. So this is all about the metabolic and the deficiency disorders in case of dairy animals. Thank you all for a patient hearing.
And, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I have a question, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Any questions of doctor?
Thank you, Vikani, sir.
Dr. Vakchaure and Dr. Dr. Vakchaure, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your informative and practically applicable presentation on the metabolic diseases and deficiency diseases in bovine. Most of the vets from all over parts of the country attended this webinar. And some of the questions I will ask from their chat section because it is not possible that every question will be asked. here due to timing. Dr. Jitendra Patak sir asked that the most of the cases in calcium deficiency are came to clinic or veterinary dispensary that are treated by someone who has given a lot of calcium. Still, there is a recumbency and there are more chances of myocarditis in such cases. What should be protocol we should follow for such case? Please, Bikane sir.
Repeated administration of the calcium is being done because of two reasons. One, that is improper diagnosis. That may be the case of calving injury, and that is being treated with calcium. Second, that may be case of milk fever, but there may be a concurrent hypophosphatemia or hypomagnesemia. So I have listed 10 causes in my presentation. And instead of giving calcium, it is better to provide phosphorus and even magnesium, compound calcium preparations containing calcium, phosphorus, and magnesium in a low doses to those animals. Second, the Nervine tonics they are required, even the muscle tonics like organic mask, organic phosphorus preparations can be used. In such type of cases, again, we can go for epidural injections of steroids and Nervine type of the tonics. But the most important is the nursing and care of the animals. These animals usually, actually I didn't discuss that particular part, but supporting and nursing care of the animals suffering from milk fever. Actually, due to improper care of the animals, some good cases of milk fever also, they are converted into, you can see, the downers. So, keeping the animal on a soft bedding, turning the animal from one side, means changing the sides of the animals, providing good bedding, and lifting the animal, making the animal to stand, that is very, very important in getting the recovery. Actually, in such worst type of the cases, I've seen that medicines will work to the extent of 10%, 90% is the nursing and care of the animal. So, changing of the side, provision of soft bedding, care of the bed sores, and lifting the animal, holding the animal in a standing position by using cow lift, like you can see the equipment. So that proves very much useful. Some cases they may take even 1 week, 2 weeks for a complete recovery. So that line of treatment should be adopted. Some cases may not recover and they need even a disposal also.
Okay, thank you, sir. The second question is, are there any PH paper diagnosis of ketosis, or there is any paper kits like PH paper? Is there available? Ketos, some questions
asked. No, keto sticks are available now. Keto sticks are paper strips are also available, keto sticks. For even detection of the glucose and detection of the ketone bodies, they are available.
Okay.
Next question is from milk fever. Dr. Anil Kumar had asked, can we use atropine sulfate to handle the complications due to tachycardia in calcium toxicity?
Yes. Yeah, you see, in case of calcium toxicity, the atropine sulfate is considered the antidote. And the another antidote which reverses the action of calcium, that is the magnesium. So calcium and magnesium, they are again antagonistic. So calcium, diluted magnesium can also be used, but under field condition, the atropine sulfate is easily available. So that can be used. But I am of the opinion that we can prevent calcium toxicity to the great extent if we follow the tips which we have discussed today. That giving calcium slowly, keeping the calm and quiet animal, and monitoring the patient.
Sir, regarding from Karnataka, one question is there is sugarcane, they are feeding more amount of sugar in top area. threaten calcium, more cases of calcium deficiency. What is the relation? Can you elaborate some?
Please repeat. So, there was some.
There is a question that in Bidar area, they are more feeding sugarcane tops.
Yes.
So their case of hypocalcemia are seen. So
now it is a common practice in a sugarcane growing area. In Maharashtra also, in many parts, the sugarcane top, that is the fodder available for our animals during summer season. Sugarcane tops, no doubt, they are deficient in phosphorus. They are optimum in calcium. They are deficient in phosphorus, optimum in calcium, but they contain more oxalate. And oxalates, they reduce the absorption of calcium. And therefore, the absorption of calcium from the diet may be reduced when the sugarcane tops are fed to them. So we can maintain the calcium level in animals fed on the sugarcane tops by providing surplus calcium through the diet, by providing mineral mixture, or by giving, you can see the lime water treatment to the sugarcane tops.
Okay. Sir, one more question is from ketosis. Ketosis.
Yes.
Few cases show clinical signs of ketosis, but they came negative on Rotrastase. But they respond well to dextrose therapy. This is the question from Haryana. Why it happens?
These are the false negative reactions to the Rotrastase test. Sometimes the ketone bodies, there are 2-3 reasons. Number one, the urine collected should be properly stored, it should be kept in a refrigerator. Then only ketone bodies will remain stable. If you are collecting the sample from the field and if you are testing it after 6 hours, it will prove negative. If you are keeping it open, then the sample will be negative. Apart from this, if a freshly collected sample is negative, then it is due to presence of more amount of butyric acid, beta hydroxybutyrate in the urine sample, and which cannot be detected by the Rotrastase test. In that case, you will have to warm up the urine sample, you have to boil it to some extent, and then you have to perform. In that case, the test will be positive. We call it the false negative type of the test. Animal is positive for ketosis, but test is negative. So this possibility is there. Response to the treatment, in my opinion, is very important. That is a confirmative one.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for your nice presentation and informative talk with all veterinarians of the India. Most of the veterinarians are from all parts of India. They are saying that this will be very helpful for field level, because most of the talks sometimes limited to the laboratory diagnosis, but this talk is highly effective. They can applicable at the field level also. May I request Dr. Ramdas Gade, sir, to give a conclusion notes and thanking note on this webinar, today's session.
Good evening, everybody. Today, nowadays, we are facing a problem of lockdown due to COVID-19. In such days, we can't communicate each other. So with the Maharashtra State Veterinary Association, MAHAVET, as such thing, to give some start a webinars on brainstorming for the veterinarians around the country. In today's first webinar, I think 500 and more on Zoom app and thousands and more on Facebook Live. Veterinary doctors have participated in this first webinar. For this webinar, we are collaborated with my best friend, Dr. Mangesh, who is the CEO of Veterina Healthcare India Limited. He is veterinarian. And firstly, Dr. Bhikane sir, who is our very lovable teacher and professor HOD at Udgir Veterinary College, have given a very nicely presentation on metabolic diseases, disorders, the causes, how to diagnose at field level, and how to treat them. I think all the veterinarians from the India level have participated in today's webinar. I very thankful to Dr. Bhikane sir firstly, then the CEO of Veterina, Dr. Mangesh, for organizing such a webinar. And this webinar has hosted and co-hosted by our General Secretary Dr. Santosh Vagchaure and Dr. Umesh Sontakke, I will like to thank all the Indian veterinary people's veterinary doctors. We will again organizing such a webinar on the field level basis. I invite all of you to attend the next webinar. Thanks. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Yes,
thank you, Dr. Gare.
Thank you so much from all the participants.
Thank you.
Please, the session is closed.
Thank you so much. Thank you.